Thank you very much. It's very honored to be here. So thank you for hosting. So my name is Jun Rekimoto from the University of Tokyo and the Sony Computer Science Laboratories. So today's topic is human augmentation. So how technology can augment humans. So actually, let me introduce myself. This is myself about 4 years ago. So I was already interested in the user interface. So I'm concentrating on some machines, so toys. But I try to use the interface. So since then, I love technologies and the gadgets. And also, I was inspired by science fiction, animation, and science movies of how to create the future. And also, when I was the high school student, I was fascinated by the work by Ivan Sutherland of the first augmented head-mounted display. So since then, I am quite interested in augmented reality, how the technology can augment or human or augment reality. So then the first one, let me introduce the first two past example of my work. So this is very old one. It's 1994. So this is called NaviCam, which is, I believe, the first mobile augmented reality system. And at the time, maybe I said in 1994, have you ever already existed in 1994? No, okay, probably not. Probably not, okay. So at that time, I don't know you remember not, but there are cell phones, just cell phone. There are no cameras, no internet connectivity, cell phone, just cell phone. But I think that in the future of the cell phone, we have camera or sensors to understand reality and also to augment reality. So we created very simple, at this moment, we still need a big silicon graphics workstation behind the scene. So it's just LCD and camera. But I think the idea itself is quite related to today's smartphone augmented reality system. So if you put this on the real world, so the system will recognize the real world situation and so show some information. So your vision or your perception to the compute reality can be augmented. So this is the kind of very basic, but I think the very, very promising way to create an augmented reality system. And today, you should know the many smartphone application or tablet application that has AR facilities. So I want to say that this is the kind of origin. And also, we created the, probably now it's a very famous, the marker-based AR system. So it's a very simple idea. So you can use a very simple computer vision technology to recognize the rectangle shape. And how did this rectangle shape is distorted? You can recover the camera position. So you can overlay the object quite easily and quite accurate. So without using any other sensors, just a camera and computer, so you can do some kind of AR. And the other, my plus one, is the multi-touch. And around 2001, 2002, there are no real multi-touch system in the world. But I think it's a very natural idea to use more than one finger to control. But at that time, the mouse was a dominant user interface. But the mouse is quite unusual device, because if you use the manual like this, it's quite unusual in the real world. You need to do more than one finger to manipulate, which it's quite natural. But for the history of the computer user interface, mouse is quite good, but the mouse is kind of forcing people to do something like this. But then it becomes possible. I think this now it's quite popular. So like you use every day, so iPad or iPhone or smartphones, you can use multiple fingers. But at that time it's quite new. So I think it should be more natural than mouse, because we use multiple fingers every day. So using multiple fingers for a computer interaction should be a very natural idea. So if you're familiar with the Bezier curve, so it quite requires four control points. So for the mouse, it's very difficult, because mouse can control at one point at the same time, but you can control more than two points at the same time. So now it's a very familiar, it's a pinching, but this is the first realization of pinching in the world. Okay, but I think when I invented the smart skin, it should be a very, very natural idea, because for the history of the computer vision, so using multiple finger of the camera is quite natural, already there. So I just implemented it on the surface interaction. But still, it's quite useful, I think. So these two, NaviCam is a mobile AR system, and also Smart Skin is a multi-touch system. It's my past work and that I loved. And also, it's quite related to the human augmentation, because Navicam is augmenting the real world, and the smart skin is augmenting our manipulation abilities. Okay, so let's move on to today's topic, which is human augmentation. But first of all, I think you should be surprised about this event. So the AlphaGo beat the Mr. Lee Sedol, who is the world champion of Go. And how the computer intelligence and also the human intelligence can compete. But actually, more than the 20 years ago, there was a similar match or historical match versus the Kasparov, who was the world chess champion. Also, Deep Blue was the supercomputer, and Deep Blue beat Kasparov. And at that time, if the computer can do better than human champion in the chess, it's kind of chess, the end of chess. So some may thought this is the end of chess. But actually, maybe computer is better than human. But actually, there is very interesting activities happening, which is called advanced chess or cyborg chess. So in this league, they are having the team of the human player and the computer, how about a player team, and then make a chess match. So it turned out that this team, human-computer team, is better than human. It might be possible. And also, the human plus computer is still better than computer-only player. So that indicates if we can design a good combination of the machine, computers, and humans, so this should be much more better than computer itself. So this is basic, I think, the promise of the human-computer interaction. And this idea itself is not so new. So this is the Douglas Engelbart quote. So he is very famous for inventing graphical user interface and also mouse. But he also answered at the interview that the mouse was just a tiny piece of a much larger project aimed at augmenting human interaction. That means the mouse is just a method. But his vision is to enhance human intelligence. And also, I also very much inspired by this augmenting human intellect vision, but also want to add more physical, not just the human intellect, but the physical ability can also be augmented by technologies. So I want to say that the ultimate technology augments humans. And at this moment, in our laboratory, we are mainly doing three things. So the augmenting individual, that means we can augment like a wearable system or processing devices to augment physical ability of individuals. And the second one is augmenting existence. It's kind of telepresence. So you can be free from at this position to the go to the any other place. So you can augment the existence. And the third one is augmenting ability acquisition. So the system can enhance your ability, learning skills. So for the telepresence system, we are consider two types of human machine or human computer integration. The first one is human drone integration. So when you think about you want to fly like a bird, so it's kind of a kid's dream. But it's very difficult. So just attaching just attaching something to you is still very difficult. But if you can connect the drone and humans, and if the drone can behave as you move, and also the vision of the camera information from drone to the human, so you feel that you are flying. So then you can use your physical ability to control the drone. So if you use a normal remote command, it's rather difficult. But if you feel that you are the drone, it's rather easy to manipulate like this one. So this is kind of human-computer integration. So it's a combination of the different abilities. The human can understand the situation, and the drone can fly. So if you can combine these two, so we can create some kind of human-computer integration that the virtually fly. So we want to say this combination from the very famous science fiction called Neuromancer, and we want to say this is Jack Quinn. And do you know this science fiction? William Gibson. So it's almost 30 years old, but it's the origin of cyberpunk. And William Gibson used the Jack Quinn as the connecting to the cyberspace. You Jack Quinn to the cyberspace, like a virtual reality. they want to slightly extend this concept, jack-in to the drone or jack-in to the other person. So you can connect to, immersively connect to other entities, including humans and robots. And also, there is a term jack-out. Jack-out is disconnect from the jack-in status. So I want to use this notion as an out-of-body, like your mind is disconnected from yourself to go to the outside. So in this case, we are again using drone, but if you have out-of-body view from your entity, it means you can see yourself from outside. So it should be very useful for the training. So this is the out-of-body vision drone. So when you are doing sport like jogging or swimming, so it is very important to know what kind of form you are taking. But normally it's rather difficult to by how your style. But in this case, there's outside of body vision drone is flying around you and sending information to you. So you can see yourself from outside. So this is drone version. And also we created the swimming version. So are you familiar with swimming? Do you like swim? So swimming is rather much more difficult to know what kind of swimming form you are taking. So you are like doing this. And even the coach has a difficulty to knowing the swimming form. But if you, this kind of robot is available, so it provides your view from outside. And also if the coach can jack in, coach can connect to this robot. So it means that the coach and swimmer can swim together and they indicate like this one. So this is another way to connect human and robot, and also watching yourself from outside, so jack in and jack out. So I show the drone human connection, drone maybe swimming robot connection. So this is human machine connection. And we also see the other possibility is a human-human connection. So this means if yourself, your perception is connected to other person, and other person can help you, so these two persons can help each other. So maybe you want to share the very exciting moment like this one to others, or you can connect it to the other person, and you maybe the cooking expert, you jack into yourself, and the cooking expert can help you. So this is the basic concept. And I want to also introduce the very old TV show. I don't think you are familiar with it. This is called Probe. It's a TV series. You don't know, it's the 70s. So when I was in Japan, so there is a TV show in Japan, and I was fascinated with this idea. So it's a kind of spy movie. But it's 70s, it's amazing. But this is a wearable idea. So it's a small camera. And you can attach it to the body of a spy. But it's not just the augmented reality, augmented wearable device, because behind the scene, the human support staff is connected to this spy.
Okay. Clip onto these handsome cufflinks, custom designed by Cameron Accessories. Some probes prefer to wear it on a watch,
so this
ring,
is amazing.
Tie-tack.
Remember, this
others
is
like myself like to wear it right on the button.
Like this. It's a very beautiful wearable computer.
He has a tiny receiving set that's tuned into our sound channel, and it is right
like
there.
Also, auditory
augmented well, I don't
see
anything.
It's already available.
An implant?
And the example
it's a permanent
is...
permanent built-in ear jack.
Well, can someone else hear it? Someone standing close to him?
No, it's a neuro implant. Ms. Keats, would you put up the software?
So this is
package.
The backup center.
Probe control.
So the many staff is supporting this the spy agent. So for instance, this is the scene. So remember, at that time, there are no GPS, no smartphone. So you should know the way, which way to go.
Which way?
No, I didn't have a map. Let's see.
So he initially didn't know. But the backup center can check it. And the indication to this person.
There, why don't we try left for about 6 kilometers and then hang a right?
A superb sense of direction.
That's what you might call a built-in compass.
Or even though you arrive to some place.
just what we need. Klopfen Sie doch bitte nicht an die Tür und fummeln.
Please don't knock on the door and ring the bell.
Even though you don't understand,
yes.
The backup sub can translate it.
Sind Sie Engländer?
Are you English?
American.
Perhaps okay. That explains it.
So this the idea. And, okay, and also, and the other inspiration. Do you also know the this brainstorm? It's also a very famous science fiction movie in 80s. So this is kind of brain mass interface movie. So there is a future device that can take your perception to, and transmit to the others. So you can record it, your total experience like this one. Or also you play it back. Like this one. Notice that there is an open, big open reel tape back there. And also they notice that it is old-fashioned model. But basically, if this kind of future device is possible, so your experience can be shared and maybe other guys can support you. So this is more so the idea of human-human connection. Okay, so stop playing back science fiction movies. And then, I came up with the idea that even though the brain machine is not possible, but we can create kind of wearable computer that can cover the 330-degree camera. So we can at least share our surrounding environment. So we created this one, so which is called Jacqueline Head. So this, at this moment, this has six cameras that surround you. And the idea is to send your immersive environment to others, and that others can share your experience, and also others can support you. So like this one,
wide-angle camera.
So if you put this one, so your 360-degree image can be captured and transmitted or recorded. So you can re-experience this by using maybe head-mount display or cable-like screen, virtual reality system, or you can do bungee jump like this one. Okay. So maybe the future of the TV broadcasting system. Not just the camera from the outside, but if you, this kind of device will be popular, so you can be some particular person, or maybe you can be a sports player, or you can be a singer. So you can reshare the first-person experience. But the one problem is, if you look at the first-person video, like attaching this, this is very hard to see. Did anybody see the movie called Hardware Henry? No? Hardcore Henry. It's the first person movie. I think I found that the theater in San Jose is showing. But it's totally very hard to see because everything is shaking. So you strongly feel motion sickness. So how to compensate is more important. And also, I try to challenge you to re-experience Giant Swing. Okay. So he's wearing the head, jacket head. So have you ever seen or have you ever tried Giant Swing in your life? No. Yes? You can. Oh, yes. That's nice. So I can ask you. So this is the view from the Jacqueline Head without doing any stabilization. Okay, so this Giant Swing, and so this is one video, one camera. And this is the total camera. Okay. So be patient, but this should be very, very... you may feel motion sickness. And if you use the head-mount display, it's much more strong effect. So everything is rotating, okay. So then technology comes in. So you should be familiar with the technology called stabilization to compensate motion. So actually, what we're creating is a 330-degree image, it's an image of a sphere. And if you track the feature point, or you track the optical flow of this on the sphere, so you can calculate the rotation of this sphere, and then you can compensate this rotation. So basically, you can stop rotation. So when after applying this compensation or stabilization, what you will see is like this one. So this is still rotating, but then it stops, you notice. So even though you feel that this motion, but this rotation can be compensated. So I think that this is much more comfortable to watch, but still it's an excitement of kind of first-person experience. And I want to ask you, is this really near what you feel, or the previous video is more closer to your actual?
The previous video is a lot closer.
A lot closer.
Okay.
Okay,
understand
yeah.
your flow.
Yeah. So I had many athletes, but somebody says that this is much more closer because, or if the world is rotating, but they can concentrate one point, something like that. So they, mentally, they can stop kind of rotation. So I think the just showing the first person video might be not the correct answer, but if this kind of technology can comes in, so it should be the combination of the first person experience and also the comfortableness. So we think that this kind of information can be possible. So the and also we explained the jack in. So this is the first person bit and the jack out is also the third person bit out of body. So we maybe connect this. So it means that you starting from the first person, one particular person, and then move to the another person or look at the other side. So this kind of, it's kind of experimental video. But if you're starting with from one person, so then it's connected to the three-dimensionally generated space, and you extract it from this person, so you will see this person, like this one, and then you switch to the another person. So if this applies to the sports game, so you can play with one particular player, but then you can extract it from the outside, and you can see the third person view to the studio, and then went to the other player, like a goalkeeper, something like that. So then I explained that how the human connection can be possible, and also, so this is maybe a sports scene. So this is the first person view of shoot, but also you can see the outside view, and also you can change viewpoint from here or like this one. So we think that if this technology becomes possible, becomes popular, so we can connect the ability of human over the internet. So maybe I want to say this is internet of abilities, like internet of things. So the ability can be connected over the internet. So maybe IoT is for the device and device internet. So this is ability internet, so which will be called IOA. So I want to say that this is the next generation of the IoT. IOA is the next generation of IOA. Okay, and the other possibilities the existence of human to the remote location, like this one. So what I mean is now this kind of telepresence robot becomes very popular, and this guy, I think the four telepresence robots are used, and this is Ubicomp. Back in 2014, so the participant like this one is attending the conference. So now it's getting very popular, or like a conversation with this kind of. And also, this is Kai, a few days ago, like this. And also, I think this is popular in Mountain View. So I downloaded it from YouTube. This is someday in Mountain View, it said. So the television robot is trying to buy coffee as a proxy of the remote person. Like this one. And the shop boss asked the fourth here or to go. and remote boss answers to go, of course. But it is possible to, the kind of robot surrogate can do for you. So it's not autonomous robot. So somebody is connecting behind. But this is good, but some problem is still the difficulty of the getting there. So maybe you need a human help, or like this one. So one of my students came up with a very strange idea. So if the Uber is the sharing driver services, why don't we share the human? Okay. So it's kind of human Uber. Or maybe the future student volunteer can provide you a 30 minute to be a proxy of the other person. So this is the very simple idea, but of course, it's just a body, so you can climb anywhere, or you can this person, this proxy can open door. But we found it's quite like initially it's a kind of joke, but it turned out it's quite interesting because we tend to trust this as a remote person, even though I know the situation.
We propose convenient masks. So physical and social
like this. So even though I know that this person is different from this face. But when I have a conversation, I tend to trust this as a remote person. And also, so it's a kind of situation like this one. So there is a proxy or surrogate we're wearing face. And also, it's also video virtual reality. So he can also see the real world. And this information can be transmitted to this local remote person. So like this one. So actually, there are two, the face display and also the other iPhone here. So their camera can provide view for this head-mount display. And this view is provided to the other person. And also like this one. So this white hand is a remote person's indication. So we tried at CHI last year. So we have a proxy presenter. So even though this person can remotely present, and it works very well. And also we tried in the city office in Tokyo, and tried to get a public paper. As if this proxy as a remote person, this person almost believed in this face is real. So when I provided the driver license, so he trusted that this inside the body is this face. Okay, so being other person is difficult, but by just changing face, it should be one possibility of the making the human-computer proxy. So we think that this is kind of new work style, maybe the human Uber. So we can share the work time. So you spend 30 minutes, you want to provide 30 minutes for the other person, so you can be a proxy or surrogate of other users. And also, I see the possibility of this is kind of new types of role-playing or learning. So if you are not a good presenter, but you put this face, and the remote, maybe the presentation expert can jack in to this face, and you can just behave like this. Then it's a kind of role playing. So I think you should learn something by these activities. Okay. So this is another human-human connection. So far I talked about mainly the visual communication or visual connection of telepresence. How about the other perception like audio or force. So I want to introduce one other topic of the force. So this is at this moment not directly connected to a human-human connection, but the potential it can be used for human-human connection of the tactile. So if you're familiar with the tactile user interface, tactile feedback devices, there are two categories of tactile devices. The one is to create real force. So this is like this real force. And the other is a tactile vibration. So it's just a feedback, not a force, but maybe this kind of vibration possible. So when you put the cell phone, you feel some vibration. This is a tactile display. So this is good for virtual reality, for instance. So it can create a real force. But it requires some very heavy mechanics, or like this one. And this part is light and mobile. But it can create force. So maybe this kind is the pros and cons of tactile devices. So if we can combine lightweight or mobile, but still it can create force, it should be better. And by using human illusion, it is possible. It is possible, actually. And I submit a paper to the WIST a couple of years ago, and nobody believes in. So the reviewers didn't believe. So the reviewer asked me to do live demo during my talk. And this time I also bring this because just showing this is not so convincing. So this is a traction device. So I think this video is not so convincing, I guess, because the tactile device, you can just look at this. So do you mean the idea? So this becomes a create force. So if you put, this one, so you feel actually force more just for this one. So it can be used for maybe, okay, so this, I skip it. So this part actually feels the force of this way and that way. So if the device can create force, it should be useful for navigating device. So maybe for people with visual disability, or even though you are using the cell phone, you want to walk, so you have to be navigate by force, okay? Or if you the device like this one can create force, so that this device can automatically navigate you to the particular position. So I think the virtual force is quite important for the interactions. So then I want to try live demo, but if somebody want to try, I can provide you. Okay, just a moment. So in this box, we should have device. So actually it just creates the sound like this one, or maybe just a sine wave like this one. Okay, so if this vibration is connected to this, probably this one, I think. I think this is not convincing, so I think I want somebody to actually try, okay. Actually, it's this device. You hold like this one.
Oh. Uh-huh.
Do you understand?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So if you just a sine wave, you feel the nothing. So if you vibration, but no force. So how about this? When we just a square wave, still don't see slightly, okay. Oh. And also, this you maybe feel some other motion. Yeah, so back and forth. Okay, so later I try some other person. Yeah, so demonstrating tactile device is very difficult during the presentation. So, like this. So this is another scene. So she first tried this device. Oops.
The limitation of the sensor or of the our mechanoreceptor, sir?
This is mechanical.
Hi.
Hi.
ウェイトしたいって言います。下とか右とか。上だけわかる気がします。今上しかやってない。あ、そう。ああ、だ、ストリング。すごい。で、帰りは速度が。おお。いや、違うかったですね。本当に行く。すごい。ちょっと行きたくなってきちゃった。
よろしいですか。はい。Okay. So the The inside of this is just a piezo actuator. So the it vibrates like this one. So the, we measure the vibration like this by using the laser sensor. So it's kind of like this. So if you put this input, so the vibration pattern like this one. So it's a damping effect. So one shot you create something like this. So if we add just a sine wave or a normal square wave, so vibration pattern like this, acceleration like this one. So in this case, we don't feel any force. So we feel vibration, but no force. But the very simple evidence, we like add the, like a asymmetric like this one. So pattern like this, and then we start feeling force like this one. So we also measure the how much of the weight can be created, force can be created by comparing the real physical weight and the virtual weight. So we can put like this, and if the participant feel the same magnitude, so the participant say yes, and we also confirm that it's about 30 grams we can create it. So the reason why, so this is probably based on the human non-linearity of perception. This is known as Stevens power law. So that is the, if you add a stimulus, it's not just a, if the stimulus and your perceived magnitude of the estimation is same, so this should be like normal line. But it's not linear like this one. So if you feel like this one, so that means it's the vibration pattern like this. And simply integrate this, it should be of course zero. So it's just a vibration, acceleration, so plus minus zero. But if this is the your sensation magnitude, so then the integration is no longer zero. So that is why we can feel the force. So this indicate, or other possibilities, maybe in the masking effect of sound. So the lower weak vibration immediately after the strong vibration may be masked by, so like a sound. So in this case, this way you can feel this way much more than that way. So this is another hypothesis. I still don't know, but so in this case, so even though this kind of very simple vibration, you can create force or something. So it's quite important for human-computer interaction because creating real force is very, very difficult because you need some mechanical. But if you can hack your perception, it should be a lot of possibilities to make very cheap but still the convincing something. So it is also the very important field of human-computer interaction, how you can understand the perception system and how you can use this perception system can for some engineering purpose. So I think reality is not just a real. Reality, we only feel reality through our perception. So reality is, for me, or for humans, is only a perceived illusion. So that's one message, okay. And then go to the next project. So this is also happiness. So I think the happiness of human augmentation is quite important. And it is important. So are there any possibility to create interaction device that make you happier. So this is a very, very difficult problem because you need more deep understanding of humans. So, but I think the making people happy is quite important. And one possibility is called facial feedback hypothesis or somatic psychology. So if you're familiar with this quote, we don't laugh because we are happy. We are happy because we laugh. So that means maybe the smile facial expression is not just a result of your brain activities. If you have a facial expression like a smiling, so this activity itself is affecting your mind. So this facial expression is an external representation, but this is not just external. So it's a bidirectional interaction. So the four people, I think the depressed, I think having a good posture is very good for care. So this is your physical activity, the internal activity is highly connected. So this is one experiment of how our facial expression affect on humans. So this research asked two groups holding pencil like this one. So one group is holding like this one, and the other is holding like this one. Okay. So it looks like smiling, okay. But not because they are happy, just because they're holding this one. And then apply some kind of psychological questions. And then this is significantly better. This group is significant positive, better positive. So that means the even though this kind of very artificial way to create facial expression like a smiling still affect on your mind. So I suggest that if you are not happy, I suggest you to hold the pencil like this. Okay. But if this study suggests if the interface device that can encourage smile, so that make you happy. So then it can be can be possible using the normal or interaction device. So we created happiness counter like this. So this is a very simple device. It's a camera that can simply detect smile facial expression and have a very simple feedback system like this. So we put this in the many places in everyday life, like a mirror. So it's simply acknowledge when you smile, okay. It's a totally simple idea. But in everyday morning, probably you brush your teeth, but you don't smile. So maybe you something like this. But if the mirror acknowledges you when you smile, so probably you are more motivated to having smile facial expression. So that means you can be more positive. And this is the feedback, just feedback. Second one is more challenging or crazy one. It won't open, okay, won't open. So this refrigerator won't open until you smile. So the two grab a drink, you need to smile. Then you can open it. But it's kind of exercise system, so we need the fitness, so the smile is a kind of fitness. So then try to open it. And actually, this is installed in my laboratory. And I asked many visitors to do this. And initially, they are very skeptical. But I try to smile and open it. Apparently, they have become very, very positive. So we submitted this to the design contest in Japan. And we got the Good Design Award of the future of the refrigerator. Okay. And we also did a field test of the senior couple of the home. And we installed this for 10 days. And this is first one, day one. So he is trying to smile, but it's not so natural, I guess. But 10 days later, so it should be more natural. And also, we did a survey. And this person answered that the communication of the couple family can be more encouraged. So I think the facial expression is a very simple way. But if you encourage smiling, for instance, so it affects on ourselves. So it's also the other way to create human-computer interaction device that make you we happy. So we also installed this in Ubicomp device demonstrations. And normally, you demonstrate something at the conference. So probably visitors can give you comment. And some is possible, and some is not possible. But if in this case, we ask first smile and then please give a comment. So everybody says, it's good. So reaction is quite positive. And also, this is motivation of the future brainstorming room. So this is but example. So nobody is smiling. So we won't create any new idea. So everybody is stuck. So I think that having smile for the idea generation is also quite important. So I think no innovation without smiling will be possible. So maybe we can ask this happiness counter at the door, in front of the door of the meeting room. So you have to smile at least once, to join this conversation. Then I think the meeting should be very exciting. Okay, or maybe, sorry, similar things. Okay, so this is the alarm clock. See, it won't. As you guess, it won't stop until smile, okay? Won't stop, so you have to smile. Okay, so from the beginning of your day, you can be happy. Okay, so it might be a kind of joke, but we are more serious because even this kind of very simple interaction, but still you will be amazed at how you can feel positiveness when you try this one. So this, again, is a very important thing of human-computer interaction. Because human-computer interaction is not just about technology. It's about human behavior. So in this case, normally human-computer interaction is for convenience or efficiency or production. So you can search faster than humans, or you can type faster than, or so everything is performance or efficiency. But in this case, this is totally not about convenience. Ah, okay. So this is not quite inconvenience device. So the refrigerator, it won't open until you smile. It's a quite inconvenience device. But still, it's better for you. It's good for you. It's kind like a fitness device or exercising device. So exercise is not convenient, of course. But exercise is good for you. So there are some activities for humans that is not convenient, but important. And then the human-computer interaction should support this kind of activities. So maybe we can design small challenges and maybe kind of small feedback. And then in the long run, you can get benefit. It's quite similar to the fitness exercise. So I think back to the initial topic of human versus computer, and if the computer can do everything, is this good for you? I don't think so. So it's a kind of dystopia of the modern times. So everything is automated, is not good for you. So there are two activities, of human and the task that can be better to leave it, like a Roomba. So you can simply delegate it. So this is one way, of course. Or automatically self-driving car, so you can simply delegate car to drive it. So it's for efficiency and convenience. I think this is very important, of course. But the other activities like healthcare or sports or exercise or maybe happiness. So things to do your own, there is something. And then interface can support or motivate, encourage. So there are two things. Now there are two things are important. That how, if you are designing, if you're creating your human computer interaction devices, which one you are designing is, I think, important. And this is also related to the more, not just efficiency or not just convenience, but the more the satisfaction or maybe motivation, achievement, or even the dignity or happiness. And I want to introduce, this is not our work, but I quite impressed by this work, by Lyft Labs. I think this is the startup in Silicon Valley. So this is the cutlery for people with physical disabilities.
Mealtime brings people together.
And particularly the Parkinson's disease. So if you suffer from Parkinson's disease, your muscle is vibrating. It's called tremor. So it's very hard to hold fork and spoon cutleries like this one. So you cannot eat by yourself. It's a very, very sad situation, and you may lose your dignity. So maybe the robot can support you, but it's still not good, because normally we can do something like by ourselves. It's the origin of our achievement. So if the device can, again, the stabilization, in this case, mechanical stabilization becomes possible. So we can create like this one. So the stabilizing fork can support even though the people with the Parkinson's disease, they can eat by themselves. So I think the by own is quite important for the notion of achievement, the notion of dignity. So I also think that it's a very nice, a very beautiful idea of human augmentation. So even though the human augmentation, not just about super humans, but with this kind of supporting people with physical disabilities is quite important. So it's a, I think, beautiful example of human device, human machine integration. So let me start with the last example. So I think the physical activity like exercise or sports is becoming more important because we are facing this society of senior ages. So how the computer technology, IT technology can combine normal sports, or how can create new types of sports, is I think very promising and very also exciting area. So I want to introduce my laboratory. This is hoverboard. It's a drone ball. So this is also, again, it's just inspired by the movie. So my inspiration is also came from the science fiction movie or fantasy movie. So this is the Harry Potter's, and this is Quidditch. You may know. So in this case, the ball can behave automatically, and the player can fly. Also fly.
Despite the competitive nature of the sport, Quidditch is a game that brings together.
So similarly, if you have a ball contained drone, so the ball can autonomously fly. So we can simulate normal physics, normal Newton dynamics, but we can also create a future dynamics, any imaginary dynamics like this one. So maybe a computer game can be combined with physical games. And the other important is maybe in this case, you can see. So there is huge ability mismatch between two players. So there may be young people and seniors, or child and players. So if the ball can slow down, so this compensates the ability mismatch between players. So this is the scene like this one. Playing with the ball. So this is a normal ball, okay. And we are creating the ball of with drone. So this is simulating very weak gravity. Or maybe the ball can simply following you. So you already you always catch. Or other possibility for the kids. Maybe he cannot handle ball, but simply flying above this kid. That also motivates physical motion. So this is only one example, but this kind of maybe IT can, how the information technology, how the robotics technology can enhance the physical ability, physical activities, is I think another very important, or he is inventing kicking, important area of human-computer interaction, I think. So far, I introduced the human augmentation. I'm starting from telepresence step, human-human connection, human-robot connection. And I think this is a very famous triangle, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So this is starting from the physiological safety, but the higher levels, you know that the self-actualization or esteem is important. So we think the human-computer interaction also support this area. So how our self-actualization can be achieved by technology is a very important topic of human-computer interaction, I believe. So this is our vision of the human-computer interaction. So human augmentation is not just replacing you, but technology makes you happier, more active, and more exciting. Okay, so thank you very much. And this is my student who created real work. So please, so I want to stop here. Thank you very much.
We have a few minutes for questions, comments. On the actuator, the integration is zero. So if I put it on a table, it's not actually moving, right? Even though there's a...
If you have a friction of the surface, it moves.
I see.
But if you hold like this, of course it don't move. It doesn't move. But if you put this, so the surface effect of the... So make it move. Does it make sense?
Wondering if you could, so obviously those other effects you were talking about in terms of, you know, the power law and other things,
yes,
definitely affect it, but it seems like if basically you have skin stretch sensors in your finger,
mm-hmm,
and there's friction between your finger and the device, and so it might be just sort of activating those, is it activating the skin stretch?
I mean this,
yeah.
I think,
yeah,
it might be possible.
So, what's your perspective on augmenting your service team, for example? Because sometimes you actually have to change. There's psychological theory on that you behave different with different people,
mm-hmm,
and you assume different personality roles with different people.
Yes.
Do you think it will be important that we adapt to these personality changes given the context? Sometimes I'm talking to a professor versus talking to my mom versus talking to... Should we adapt technology for augmenting these situations? And how? What would... I was just picking on the brain on this perspective.
Interesting question. It might be possible by combining other personalities, but I don't have quite good answer right now. So thank you for the comment.
So You know, you were an early pioneer in multi-touch and then also in augmented reality. And now, you know, we've seen multi-touch take over pretty much a lot of our interaction, and augmented reality is just starting to. When do you think, or what are the challenges to take some of these more augmented, physical augmentation in terms of the robotic works that you're doing, or the more camera-based things that you're doing? What, how, when do you see that taking over, and how, what are the main challenges to get there in terms of adoption outside of your lab?
So maybe the Jack Beckett, as I showed, this is where cameras will be more close to the real industry, I guess. So the, maybe the future of the report person can wear this, not just holding camera. So the, this is one way of the realizing this research. And also the happiness counter, we are currently researching the actually the idea generation process connected to the human facial expression. So this is, I think, the quite promising. So the, how the, we, how, when we create new ideas, so we normally smile. So the, this combination can be used for real world applications.
So the actuator combined with the third person or first person view that you talked about, have you thought about combining them to give a more realistic impression of what that person is feeling at that time? Like, let's say the person who was playing basketball, if you have the first person view plus the actuator, would you think that that would give a realistic impression in terms of sensation and in terms of touch and sight?
I think it should be possible. So they maybe attach this and fall to guide the real player.
For the human Uber idea, it's a very intriguing idea. There's obviously the problem of like who is going to serve as like the as the person who's like wearing the mask, right? I was wondering, is there any way that you could make it such that the person who is like wearing it is like doing it while they're sleeping, like essentially sleepwalk.
I never thought about it. So you mean that the surrogate is sleeping?
Yes.
Yeah. How come he can?
There's probably a few people who would be willing to serve as surrogates, right? Can you get people's idle time?
Might be. I like this.
Have you experimented with other types of sensations for happiness? There's some, I've seen some cool research that if you move your body in certain ways, you can transmit happiness. For example, this type of movement is very happy. Like if you move your arm this way, or if you have certain type of motions, not only you know their face, but your body can induce also happiness.
Yeah,
just
you're right.
You move it. Maybe using your sensor, you can force people to move in a happy fashion.
Yeah, we didn't, but it's very nice comment.
About the happiness counter. So I'm wondering the level of facial expression and detail that it captures, is it simply looking for a smile, or is it actually looking for the more complex facial activation units?
Yeah, so it's a very good point, because we currently use off-the-shelf smile detector. Mm-hmm. So the one problem is once you understand the feature of this smile detector, so we can artificially create smile facial expression.
Right.
So this I think this normally facial expression that was kind of small, some feature point, tracking feature point, and then they classify normal and facial expression. But human smile is much more subtle, or maybe also involved in the time sequence. So if the more sophisticated the facial expression detector can be possible, we can do another thing. But right now it's a very simple one. So it's very standard in computer vision.
I'm just thinking that if it's more subtle, then you don't lose as many sodas per day.
Maybe.
You, at the end, you showed the Maslow's pyramid
of
need. And one of the principles of Maslow is that the higher level needs, you know, aren't satisfied until the lower level needs aren't taken care of, right?
Yes.
Because it'd be safe and like that. But in a way, you're sort of, with the smile machine,
yes,
you're sort of starting at the other end. If you say, okay, well, if we make people, in some simple way, make people feel happy or, you know, feel they're in control of some small thing, that they feel more empowered to, you know, feed themselves well, or, you know, they may take action to become more safe, or,
yes,
you know, seek belonging, or, you know, be more effective in the lower level needs. So in a way, there's sort of a principle here that you can turn this pyramid upside down. You can start at the top, and it will have effect at the bottom, which is, I think, a very interesting idea.
I think, yeah. Thank you so much. By the way, we created the brochure of my laboratory, and we brought some of the. If you're interested in, please come here.
Okay, thank you, Rekimoto-san, one more time.